You're traveling to another dimension. A dimension not only of sight and sound, but of mind. Your next stop.
Message about Jesus. Hello. James Ofer here with you, a word from the Lord. We are so glad that you are with us tonight, and we hope that you are ready for a study from God's Word. We're going to put our contact information up after a while. We get going, and if you have a question you'd like to ask about the lesson we're studying, we'll be glad to answer that question. Of course, we want to put our contact information up for you, orphanlord@gmail.com. It's how you can reach me, 276-340-2653. We meet at the Boulevard, 250 the Boulevard in Eden, and we meet regularly on Thursday nights at 7 o'clock, and of course, we also meet on Sunday mornings at 9 o'clock for Bible study and 10 a.m. for worship. So if you are in the area, you want to study God's Word, that's how you can participate in our worship assembly and Bible studies together, and we hope that you'll do that very thing. Tonight, I want to talk about a gift. This is kind of the time of the year everybody's talking about presents and gifts and things like that. And so I thought, well, this might be a good opportunity to discuss a gift that everybody is confused about, a gift that most people don't really know what to do with. You know, now I'm not talking about the old fruitcake. I'm not talking about that fruitcake that gets passed around and around and around and around. Someone said there's only really one fruitcake, and it just keeps getting re-gifted and gifted and passed around. Not talking about that kind of gift. But it is a gift that a lot of people want, but when they talk about it, they don't really know how to use it. Maybe it's like that new iPhone 27 or whatever it is. You know, well, everybody wants to have it, but then they don't know how to use it once they get it. Well, I'm not talking about that gift either. What I'm talking about is this gift. It's grace. Everybody wants grace. And everybody talks about grace. But most people don't really know how grace works or what it is about grace that makes it so special or important. Consider if you think about it. Where would we be without grace? I mean, no doubt about it, mankind would be ultimately and unescapably lost without grace. You see, sin separates man from God. Man's sin separated him from God. Isaiah 59 verses 1 and 2, Isaiah says, "Behold, the Lord's hand is not slack, is not shortened that it cannot save, neither is ear heavy that it cannot hear, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear." So there's the division. Man and God were not in fellowship, or not in fellowship, except God's grace be available to bring them back together. And that's really why grace is so important. That's really why grace is that gift that everyone needs, because that's exactly what it does. It reconciles us. Notice in Ephesians 1 and verse 4. Ephesians 1 and verse 4. Paul says, "According as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love." So here we are, chosen in him before the foundation of the world. But how is it that we are holy and blameless before him? Well, let's come down here to verse 6. "To the praise and glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved." It is through grace that God makes us accepted. We are chosen. Notice, chosen in Christ, verse 4, chosen in him. That's not selected. A certain individual is not selected and said, well, everybody else is ignored. We'll get into that momentarily. But it tells us where we are predestined, or where we are elect, or where we are chosen. That is in Christ. In Christ is where all the elect, or all the chosen, are going to be. And therefore, that is why we're able to say we're in Christ, or accepted by God, because of God's grace. It's His grace that made us accepted in the Beloved. Who is the Beloved? Christ. Remember, God said, "This is my Beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." So now we are accepted in the Beloved. We have redemption through His blood. We are reconciled and chosen in Christ. And it's all because of God's grace. Titus 2 and verse 11. Notice this. Paul says, "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men." God's grace has appeared, that is, it has made been made manifest to all men. And so there is how man is going to be reconciled to God. Titus 3 and verse 7. "Being justified by His grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life." So justified by His grace, that is, just as if we'd never sinned, reconciled to God, accepted in Christ, all by the grace of God. That's why everybody wants that gift that is grace. Everybody wants God's grace because they know that is the only way that they are going to be accepted or justified with God. But notice this, this grace, this gift that everybody wants to have is really something that many people have confused. Now, why is that? Well, most people, when they say grace, they talk about grace, well, it's unmerited favor. It's a gift, and therefore, God gives it, and there's nothing you can do about it to change it. God gave it, and you're going to have to take it. You don't have any choice in the matter. Well, just because God is giving a gift, that doesn't rule out man's responsibility or obligation in receiving that gift. But let's digress. We'll come to that in just a moment. This is a gift that everybody wants, and it's because God was gracious enough to provide a means of escape so that man would not have to be punished by sin. Now listen, God's grace is the reason why we can be forgiven. God's grace is the reason why we have a hope of eternal life, or we can have a hope of eternal life. It is because God did something for man that man didn't necessarily deserve. Man sinned. He chose to sin. He chose to disobey God. Therefore, God would be just in destroying man because sin, the wage of sin is death. But it's God's grace that says, you know what? Even though you have sinned, I'm going to make a way in which you can be forgiven of that sin. That's God's goodness. That's God's grace. The psalmist said this in Psalm 86 and verse 15. He says, "But thou, O Lord, art a God full of compassion and gracious, long-suffering, and plenteous in mercy and truth." God is a God who is abundant and plenteous in mercy and grace. That's the reason why Jonah got so mad when he was told to go to Nineveh. Notice this, in Jonah chapter 4, it displeased Jonah when Nineveh repented. It displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was very angry, and he prayed unto the Lord and said, "I pray thee, O Lord." Now, can you imagine someone talking to God this way? "I'm mad, so I'm going to talk to God. Was not this my saying? Lord, didn't I tell you this is what you would do? I knew you. I knew that you would forgive them. This is why I fled. I knew you'd do this, therefore I fled to Tarshish, for I knew that thou art a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger, and great kindness, and repentest thee of the evil. I knew you'd do this, God." That's what Jonah's saying. "I knew you're just too gracious. You're too kind. You're too merciful. And that's why I did not want to go to Nineveh." Now, that's what we're talking about. God could have being just in destroying people who sin, but God's grace and His mercy is extended toward man so that man does not have to suffer the consequences of sin if he'll be obedient to the Lord. So that's why we talk about God's grace. But here's the question that we need to consider then about this gift that no one really understands. What is it about God's grace and man's salvation that is so hard to grasp? What is it about man's grace that so many people are confused about? Well, let's start right there. Let's talk about grace being confused. You know, most people think when they say you're saved by grace, or they talk about God's salvation, God's grace bringing salvation, they run to Ephesians 2 and verse 8, and, you know, then they're kind of like Porky Pig, you know. That's all, folks. You know, Ephesians 2 and verse 8, notice this, Ephesians 2 verse 8, this is what they say. They say, well, but wait a minute now, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not yourself is a gift of God, not by works, as any man should boast. That's it, you can't do anything. Oh, nope, stop. Stop, that's it. Nothing else, period. God does it, it's a gift. See that? Well, friends, I know this. You know, this time of year, a lot of people are going to be giving gifts, and you may not want a gift. Well, a lot of people may not want the gift of God. They may not want the grace. So you can't say, no, it's God's gift, and therefore that's it. But yet, we have people who have confused it. Notice this. Again, this is from some of the writings of the the gentleman we've been talking about the past couple weeks. I've been going over his writings. He says, if no man can come to Christ except God draws him, who makes the choice for you to come to Christ? That should be a question mark there. If God does not draw you to Christ, who decides if you are lost? Again, it should be a question mark there. Everywhere in the Bible where salvation is taught, the action is always God's action. Now, later on, Mr. Hobson is going to say this. He says, if you study the Bible diligently, you will find many scriptures to establish that we are saved by grace without our efforts. Now, see, friends, that tells me right there that grace is confused, because people say, well, it's a gift, and there's nothing you can do about it, and that's it. That's all. Well, is that really what the Bible is saying about grace? Is that really a correct and a scriptural and an accurate view of God's grace, that it's a gift and that's it, therefore you're saved because God gave you a gift? You know, just because someone gives you a gift, does that mean that you are bound to use it? You know, how many times do you get a birthday present or a Christmas present or something, and someone gives it to you and you go, you know, I'm never going to use this. You get home, I'm never going to use this. I will never, ever, ever use this gift. It was nice that they thought about it. They thought I could use it, but I can't use it. I don't want to use it. Now, isn't that the way it is with a gift? Everybody wants to say, well, it's a gift, so you have to take it. No man can reject God's gift, and we're going to show that in a minute. But notice this. People think that there's nothing to man's part of receiving God's grace. But consider this. There's no doubt, friends, that salvation comes by grace. No one is denying that if a man is saved, it is because of God's grace. We've already established the fact that God is the ultimate author of salvation, and therefore it is by His goodness and His grace and His mercy and His long-suffering that He extends the hope of salvation. But notice this. In Romans 1 and verse 24, Romans 3, 24, Romans 3, 24, look what Paul says. Romans 3 and verse 24, he says, being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Now, no, I don't have any problem with this. People say, well, there it is, justified freely by His grace. Okay, but does that mean that the person who was justified freely didn't do anything in order to meet the conditions where you can receive that gift? You know, I got to get these things in the mail from time to time. It's from an auto dealership or something. They say, hey, you win a car. Bring this key up here and you drive off in a car. Well, I may have the winning key. I may have the winning scratch-off numbers or whatever on the little card that they mail to you. But that doesn't automatically mean that I win the car. I have to go and participate in the drawing, or go and put the key in the ignition to see if it turns, opens the door, or turns, or starts the car. And so the free gift is not without some conditions on my part. being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, does not exclude that man may have to do something in order to receive that redemption that is offered by his grace. Being justified freely does not mean that you have to accept the free gift. Look at this. In 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 13, 1 Timothy 1 verse 13, here's what Paul says. Paul says, who was before a blasphemer and persecutor and injurious, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord was exceeding abundant with faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. Did the Apostle Paul have any choice in the matter? Now, Mr. Hopkins, the man that we've been reviewing his work, says that Paul was wrong. Paul wasn't really a disciple of Christ. Paul never knew Christ. But yet here Paul says he was saved by grace. Mr. Hopkins says he was wrong. Paul was wrong, but yet he said he was saved by grace. So therefore he must have been chosen by God. Well, did Paul have a choice in the matter? Did he have a choice in the matter? He could have refused to obey what he was told when Ananias said, why tarest thou, arise and be baptized and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord. Acts 22:16. He could have refused to do that. He could have refused the Lord on the road to Damascus when he said, I don't care what you want me to do, I'm not going to do it. But it was by God's grace that he was saved. It was by God's grace that he was offered the chance to obey the gospel. That's what we're talking about here. He says that before I was a blasphemer and a persecutor, but he says, I thank Christ Jesus, our Lord, who hath enabled me, for he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. But did Paul not have a choice in the matter? You see, grace does not exclude man's part in salvation. Grace does not exclude that. See, so you're saved by grace, true, but it's not grace only. It's not grace only. here's what the Baptist Manual teaches. The Baptist Manual has a statement that says, we believe the Scriptures teach that the salvation of sinners is wholly of grace. Wholly of grace. Now, friends, if salvation is wholly of grace, I mean, it's completely of grace. There's nothing else. There's no room left for anything else if it's wholly of grace. But yet, the people who write this book, who believe this, the Baptist Manual, they're going to say there's something else involved in salvation. They're going to say saved by faith. They're going to say that you must repent. They're going to say that the blood of Christ is somewhere included in salvation or has a part in it. So it can't be wholly by grace to the exclusion of everything else. See, it's not grace only. The very verse that we've been looking at, the very verse that we were talking about at the very beginning, the sugar stick, if you will, Ephesians 2 and verse 8, notice it says, for by grace are you saved through faith. The very verse that most people run to does not say grace only or wholly of grace, but it says that faith is also involved here. And so when you're talking about the grace of God that brings salvation, yes, man is saved by the grace of God, but it's not the grace of God only. It's not wholly of grace or only of grace. There are some other things that must also be considered here. So when you're talking to individuals who talk about this saved by grace and there's nothing you can do, like Mr. Hopkins, the quote we just read, nothing you can do about it. If God doesn't draw you, you're not there. God doesn't draw you in, you don't come to Christ. God's the reason why. God's the reason why you're not saved. Well, friends, there's no way that a person can say only a select group of people are chosen, predestinated before the world began to be saved. If you believe that salvation is by grace only or wholly by grace. You know why? Because the Bible says in Titus 2 verse 11, that the grace of God has appeared to all men. So if all men have access to God's grace, therefore all men must be saved. See how it is? You can't really say limited atonement according to what we know about God's grace, because it's to everywhere. If salvation were by grace alone, then everybody would have to be saved. Because the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. And so that's why I'm saying, friends, when you don't understand God's grace, you will soon find yourself misusing or confusing or being confused about what God's grace really is. Yes, salvation is from God. Yes, it is a gift of God that is provided by His grace or by His goodness, by His graciousness. But that doesn't mean that man does not have a part in it. Notice this quote. John 3:16 is the most quoted verse in the Bible, but is almost always interpreted wrong. This is not an invitation for anyone to be saved. John 6:29. God has to do a work in you before you can believe in Christ. In other words, God has to work in whosoever's life before whosoever can believe in Christ. So the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared to all men, but not really all men. The grace of God that appears to all men and thus saves all men is not going to save all men, because God is going to select who to save, even though His grace has appeared to all men. See how crazy it is? I mean, you get so twisted up, look like a can full of worms there. Well, how are you saved, by grace or not by grace? It's because people don't understand that just because God's grace is a free gift, or that salvation is a gift that is brought by God's grace or provided by God's grace and His goodness and His mercy, does not mean that men don't have a choice in the matter. Mr. Hopkins says that, well, yeah, you don't have any choice in the matter. God has to do it. If God doesn't do it, you're lost. Well, yeah, that's a really merciful and gracious God, is it not? I'm going to provide salvation to all men, but not you. Because notice this. Just because God's grace has reached all men does not mean that man is not responsible for his own salvation. How do we know that? Because there's too many places in the Bible, friends, where the Bible talks about man having a part or playing a role in his own salvation. Acts 2 and verse 40, with many other words, did he exhort them, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. Save yourselves. Now, I know what Mr. Hopkins said to this, and probably someone else. Well, Peter got it wrong. Well, friends, that's a very convenient response when the Bible contradicts what you say. But Peter's telling people to save themselves. Mr. Hopkins and others would say, no, God has to choose you. If God doesn't work in you, you can't save yourself. You can't do anything yourself. God does everything for you. Boy, this is better than being on the on the government payroll here, the government dole here. You know, you just have to, all you have to do is just wait for it, and God will show up and give it to you. Boy, that's easy, isn't it? No, friends. Man has to do a part in it. Save yourselves from this untoward generation. And so, again, if you don't understand God's grace, you'll misunderstand or you'll confuse what the gift or how it is that God gives salvation. See, everything in the scheme of salvation, everything that is said to save man is brought to you by God's grace. It's the direct result of God's goodness and His mercy and His long-suffering and His graciousness that He even provided it. That's what we're talking about here. God's goodness. He didn't have to do it. But yet, he wanted to do it. He chose, didn't have to do it, but he chose to do it. That's his goodness. That's his mercy. That's his grace. And so everything that is associated with man's salvation can then be said, well, it's by God's grace. Why? Because he is the God of all grace. 1 Peter 5 and verse 10. 1 Peter 5 and verse 10. But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. The God of all grace. Every good gift and perfect gift comes from above, down from the Father of lights, whom is no variableness, but the shadow of turning. James chapter 1, verse 17. Every good thing comes from God, because he's a good and merciful and kind and loving God. And so when you say, well, God saved mankind and it's by his grace, that's true. But it's not by his grace only. That doesn't mean that man has no part in this. You see, when you're talking about saved, a person's salvation, Jesus has a part in that salvation. He died on the cross. Yet Jesus coming is a part of God's grace to man. It is God's grace that provided the sacrifice that would take away the sins of the world. Romans 5 and verse 15. Romans 5 and verse 15. I see my background's not doing too well on TV tonight, so let's look at this. Romans 5, 15. But not as the offense. So also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift of grace, gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many. Is this God's grace that's providing this? Yes. Did God's grace give this? Yes. Is the gift of salvation as a result of God's goodness? Yes, it is. But again, don't say that it's by grace only, or don't say that man doesn't have a part in it, because that is confusing God's grace. The word that tells us about God is the word of grace. Notice this, in Acts 14 and verse 3, long time, therefore, abode they speaking boldly in the Lord, which gave testimony unto the word of his grace, and granted signs and wonders to be done by their hands. Friends, you know what the Bible is? It's the word of God's grace. Tell me something that you know about God's grace that you didn't learn from the word of God. Tell me something you know about God's grace that you know from the Bible. See, men say, well, you can't understand the Bible unless God works on you and helps you understand it. So is that really God's graciousness? Is that really the goodness of God? Is that really a free gift? God gave us the word of his grace and now we can't understand it until God tells us how to use it? You know, that's like giving someone an electronic device and say, well, I'm going to give this to you, but I'm going to take away the instruction manual and then we're going to let the manufacturer call you and teach you how to use it. And if he doesn't call you, then you don't really know how to use it. No, friends. God gave us the instruction manual right here. That's how you know everything there is about God. That's how you know about his Holy Spirit, about salvation, about his son, about his grace, about his love, about his mercy, about his severity, about his judgment, about his wrath upon those who are disobedient. Everything you know about God, you know from this. This is the word of his grace. It tells us about his goodness. And that's why, friends, when you talk about man's salvation and the grace of God, you have to talk about the Bible. That is how you know about God's grace. Yet, we hear people say, well, you know, the Bible is wrong, but I had a dream, And therefore, I tell you, really? Then why do we even have the Bible? If we're saved by God's grace, why does he need to give us a word? Go ahead and put the phone lines up, if you will, Matt. That'll be fine. You see, the word is inseparable when we're talking about the grace of God. Notice this, in Acts 20, in verse 24. Acts 20, in verse 24. Paul said, but none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. The good news of the grace of God. The Bible tells us about God's grace. It tells us about his mercy and long-suffering. And people who misunderstand God's grace more than likely will tell you that you can't understand the Bible. Now, can you imagine that? Someone says, well, we're going to understand God's grace and know everything there is about God's grace, and then turn around and tell you, but you can't understand the Bible or some of the Bible's wrong. Well, no wonder they're confused about God's grace. No wonder they think that it's a gift that man is going to has to accept regardless. That he doesn't have any choice in the matter. See, friends, here's the thing. When a man or when a person misunderstands God's grace, when they confuse God's grace and think that it is merely a gift that God gives and you have it, period, and that's it, and you have no choice in the matter, that confusion will always lead. It will always lead to something. And that's not a good something. That confusion will always lead to man turning around and saying, you know what, I think I'm going to abuse that grace. See, if man doesn't do anything and is not required to do anything, it will always lead to abusing God's grace. Now, how do I know that? Well, I see how man will abuse something else that's free. You know, if you tell someone something's free, you will have people come by and that will be gone. I mean, whatever the gift is, it'll be gone. You think people fight over stuff on Black Friday at Walmart that they're going to pay for? You just wait till it's free. I know every once in a while, I don't know what the occasion is, but I know that IHOP gives away pancakes, free pancakes, whatever. There are people that go to IHOP, they'll wait in line. Why? Because it's a free pancake. Oh, it's free. I'm going to wait in line. I'm going to wait in line all day. I'm going to miss lunch and supper. I'm going to miss breakfast and lunch waiting on pancakes for supper. Because it's free. I know Charles has talked about certain individuals that come up when they come up to the TV station up in Hollywood Hill. First thing they want, give me some popcorn. Give me a Coke. Why? Well, it's free. Right? You give me some. Charles offers us popcorn and Cokes. Sometimes customers come in and say, you know what? You're a paying customer. How about some popcorn and Coke? No, I don't care for any. Thank you, though. That's graciousness. Charles is gracious and says, I'm going to give you. He doesn't have to. He doesn't have to give you popcorn and Coke, but he says, you know what? Hey, you're a guest on the show or whatever. Hey, if you want some, you can have some. That's just gracious. Graciousness, that's extending a gift. But now when someone comes up there and says, well, every time I come up there, Charles is going to offer it to me, so I'm going to start demanding it. Hey, give me some popcorn. Give me a Coke. Now what are you doing? You're abusing the grace. Now that's how they are with God. People try to say, well, God has given me something. I'm going to abuse it. Now look how confusion leads to abuse of God's grace. Billy Graham, and listen to what they say about God, his love and mercy.
or knows Christ, whether they're conscious of it or not, they're members of the body of Christ. And that's what God is doing today. He's calling people for out of the world for his name, whether they come from the Muslim world or the Buddhist world or the Christian world or the non-believing world. They are members of the body of Christ because they've been called by God. They may not even know the name of Jesus, but they know in their heart that they need something that they don't have,
okay.
And they turn to the only light that they have, and I think that they are saved and they're going to be with us in heaven.
This is fantastic. I'm so thrilled to hear you say that. There's a wideness in God's mercy.
There is.
All right, listen to that one more time.
Tell me, what do you think is the future of Christianity?
I think everybody that loves Christ or knows Christ, whether they're conscious of it or not, they're members of the body of Christ. And that's what God is doing today. He's calling people for out of the world for his name, whether they come from the Muslim world or the Buddhist world or the Christian world or the non-believing world. They are members of the body of Christ because they've been called by God. They may not even know the name of Jesus, but they know in their heart that they need something that they don't have, and they turn to the only light that they have, and I think that they are saved and that they're going to be with us in heaven.
This is fantastic. I'm so thrilled to hear you say that. There's a wideness in God's mercy.
All right, there's a wideness in God's mercy. Here's Billy Graham going, well, I think that, you know, the future of Christianity is people are going to be coming in, they don't even know God. Well, when you believe that God's grace is so magnanimous, it's so large and encompassing, that it's going to save man, period, you assume will be bringing people in that don't even know God. You are making God's grace reach further than it ever intended. Not that God's grace cannot reach all man, but that it never was intended to be extended to individuals who are disobedient to him. Yes, God's grace appears to all men, but again, it's limited to individuals who will obey him. So on one hand, you have people like Billy Graham going, well, it doesn't matter if you obey him or not, God's going to bring you all in. Then you got on the other end of the spectrum, you got Don Hopkins and folks in the Primitive Baptist or the Calvinist that will say, no, God is not going to save everybody. He's not going to save people who will just obey him. He's only going to save people that he chooses to obey, that he has pre-selected to obey. Everybody else can just bust hell wide open. You see how confusion about God's grace leads to the abuse of God's grace? To the point that here's a very popular, well-known preacher who's saying, well, you know, you don't even have to know the name of Jesus, and you can be a recipient of God's grace. You don't even have to be really a child of God. You don't even have to know who God is. You may not even have to believe in God. But you're going to be a recipient of God's grace. You know, people get all upset when we talk about our nation and people getting benefits who are not even citizens of this country. We get all upset about that. Oh, man, they're not even citizens of our country. Why should they be on Medicare, Medicaid, and, you know, drawing unemployment and Social Security and whatever? They're not even citizens. But yet then they go hear the preacher tell them, well, you don't have to do anything to get God's grace. You don't have to do anything to receive God's grace. Just mooch off the system. Well, it's easy to see why they would leap to that conclusion. You know, they hear it from the pulpit and they say, well, if that's the way God is, maybe that's the way we should be. No, friends, that's not the way God's grace is. God's grace is not to be abused, but that's what it leads to. To the point that you have you have Paul writing to the Romans, and what does he say? In Romans 6 and verse 1, Romans 6, verses 1 and 2, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead in sin live any longer therein? Why is it that just because you think that God's grace is saving you from sin or will forgive you of your sins, then that you say, well, hey, now I have a license? And see, friends, this is really where the world has trouble. They don't want to say that man has a part in his salvation. And they don't understand how God's grace then can be extended to man. So they go to the other, they go to extreme and says, well, what we're going to do is say, well, you just do what you want to do and God will forgive you. See, the Baptists don't, they don't understand how you can say, well, I can be saved and I can sin and still be forgiven, or I can sin so much that I'll be lost and I forfeit God's grace. So it leads them to say things like this. Listen to what these folks say.
God, and he gives a whole list of things there that can't separate us from the things of God.
Okay, so in along those lines, let me ask you this then. So are you saying a child of God is saved, they're not going to be lost, never going to be lost, never fall.
What God if, didn't say they weren't going to fall because okay, they will backslide.
They're not going to be lost. They're not going to be condemned to hell.
Right.
Okay. So if someone who is saved then goes and commits fornication and dies in the very act, are they going to be in heaven?
Well, would a saved man do that?
Well, I believe so.
I don't know if a saved man honestly would do that. I mean, you know, would a saved man go out here and commit adultery? Would a saved man go out here and commit adultery? Would a saved man go out here and commit adultery?
But see, Satan doesn't understand. He did hit Tim Whiteheart, and Tim did fall. And even though he lost that battle, I know he's not going to win the war with Tim. Okay. Tim is a strong man. He's going to get back up. After the restoration process, he's going to get back up, and he's going to do something for the Lord.
I'm going to take this phone call. We'll come back to the video. You're on the word from the Lord.
Yes, sir. You were talking about Billy Graham a while ago.
Yes, sir.
And what you said about Billy Graham is a liar, is a lie, and is not true.
Did you hear what he said, sir?
I heard what you said just
I played him saying it. I played his own word. Do you want to hear it again?
Yeah, play it again.
Okay. Now you listen to what he says.
Tell me, what do you think is the future of Christianity?
I think everybody that loves
can you hear it?
Christ.
Sir, can you hear it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I didn't hear that. That sounded more like Franklin
to me. Whether they're conscious of it or not, they're members of the body of Christ. And that's what God is doing today. He's calling people out of the world for his name, whether they come from the Muslim world or the Buddhist world or the Christian world or the non-believing world, they are members of the body of Christ because they've been called by God. They may not even know the name of Jesus, but they know in their heart that they need something that they don't have, and they turn to the only light that they have, and I think that they are saved and that they're going to be with us in heaven.
All right. They don't even know the name of Jesus, but yet they're going to be saved and be with us in heaven.
Have you read your Bible? It says every nation and every kindred.
Sir.
There will be some of every nation.
Are you going to defend Billy Graham on this point? He said you don't even have to know the name of Jesus and you'll be in heaven.
Well, you know why that phone's not ringing? People have stopped watching you.
Well, you're watching me.
You're lying.
You're watching me.
Everybody knows that, and nobody wants to talk to a liar.
Well, you're talking to me.
Well, good riddance.
Well, all right. Good riddance. All right. Well, no one's watching, but the guy who says no one's watching. Now, friends, this is what we're talking about here. This is the product of this kind of confusion. Here's a man who has convinced so many people that he's telling the truth that he can say, you don't even have to know the name of Jesus and you'll be with everybody in heaven. And here's a man who calls in and says, you're lying about Billy Graham. And I play Billy Graham, and what does he say? He says, I'm lying. Well, that's the product. That's the result that you get when people don't understand God's grace. All right, here we go again. You're on the Word from the Lord.
Yeah. How you doing? This is Scott King. I was wanting to talk to James if I could.
Hey, you're on the air.
Hey, James. How you doing, buddy? This is Scott King from Charleston, North
good.
Carolina. How you doing?
I'm doing good.
Good. Are you on TV now?
Yes, sir. You're on live.
Okay. Well, good. I wanted to talk to you a second. I'm sitting here watching you, and I just heard the man talking about nobody watches you anymore, but I still watch you every week, brother, and it's been for about 2 years, and I appreciate what you're doing, and you're putting the word out there to people, and it's the truth, but it hurts sometimes, and people don't want to listen to it, and I really would like to advise them, even if it makes them mad, to look and study the Bible themselves, and look for the word, and try to prove you wrong.
All right. I appreciate that.
It's what helped me. I really want to thank you a lot, man, for what you've done for me. Even though I don't agree with everything you guys say all the time, it keeps me sharper by looking in the Bible, studying myself, and I have found so many things that I was misled on by pastors and preachers and denominations of this world that I would not have known if it had not been for you guys.
All right.
So,
hey, good to hear from you, man. We need to get back together again.
Yeah, we do, man, because I feel like studying with you, and I'm trying to do a lot of my own. I'm trying to.
I've got your number.
Pastors myself.
I've got your number. We'll try to get together pretty soon.
Okay, buddy, that sounds good. Well, just hope your viewers will at least listen to you and study for themselves, because, the best thing I ever heard was quit paying the pastor to read the Bible for me and start reading myself.
There you go.
So that's what I hope these people will do, too.
Okay.
A lot of people need another word. And I won't keep you no longer, but give me a holler. I'd love to talk to you again.
Sounds good. Good to hear from you.
All right, brother.
Have a good night. All right. Fellow we had studied with several times down in Burlington. So he's down in Burlington, Mr. No One's Watching. All right. So, friends, here's what we're talking about. Now, I'd like to continue playing this, but I'm going to run out of time, and I want to get my last point, but basically, here we have the Baptists going, well, you can fall, but you won't ever stop being loved by God, and you'll still be in heaven. A saved person wouldn't go out and commit adultery. Now, see, the problem they have is they have this misguided, a confused and warped sense of what God's grace is, so they think that it's always going to be extended no matter what you do, to the point that a saved person wouldn't commit adultery. Well, would a saved person tell a lie? I mean, do the Baptists, do they sin at all? I mean, would a saved person even sin? Would a saved person, cheat? The cashier gives you more money back than you're supposed to get. Would a saved person keep that? See? My point is, if you start saying, well, a saved person wouldn't commit adultery, well, where do you draw the line? How about you have a correct understanding of God's grace, and you'll know that God's grace will be extended if you are striving to be faithful. But when you start abusing it, then that grace is going to be rescinded. It's going to come back. Here's why. Notice this. Because God's grace can be refused. Even to the point that you once partook of God's grace and now you refuse it. Notice this. When you refuse to obey God's word, it's the same as refusing God's grace. Look at this. In Acts 20 and verse 24, we already read this one time, Acts 20 and verse 24. None of these things move me, neither can I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course of joy in the ministry which I received of the Lord Jesus to testify of the gospel of his grace. Now, there's the gospel of God's grace. So if you refuse the word, are you not refusing God's grace? Look at this in Acts 13 in verse 46. Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said it was necessary that the word of God, that's the word of his grace, should first have been spoken unto you, but seeing ye put it from yourselves and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, lo, we turn to the Gentiles. So what was Paul saying to the Jews? You could have determined to accept God's grace by being obedient to the word of his grace, which was the gospel, but you put it from you, you put the word from you, therefore you put the word of grace from you, therefore you put God's grace from you, and you judged yourselves unworthy of everlasting life. You chose to be lost. Now, Mr. Hopkins and some of the other individuals that we study say, no, you don't have a part in that. You're either saved or you're not. God does all the choosing for you. Really? That's not what the Bible says. Because the Bible says you continue in God's grace or you discontinue in God's grace. Just like you, if you obey the word of God's grace, you're continuing in his grace. But if you refuse, you fail of the grace. Look at this in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 15. Hebrews 12 and verse 15. The writer says, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. Now, friends, if you fail of the grace of God, that means at one time you were in the grace of God. Paul said in Galatians 5 and verse 4 that ye which are justified by the law, if you go back and try to be justified by the law of Moses, you are fallen from grace. You are fallen from grace. In Galatians chapter 1 and verse 6, notice what Paul says. He says, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another. And there be some that trouble you and pervert the gospel of Christ. That's the gospel of his grace. Well, what is it? If you're moved away from Christ and the grace that's in Christ, you're moved away by obeying another gospel or hearing something that's not true. Friends, you determine whether you receive God's grace or not. Yes, God's grace is a gift that is extended to every man, but you have a choice of whether you're going to obey it or not. Let me leave you with one more verse. In Acts 13 and verse 43, listen to this. Now when the congregation was broken up, many of the Jews and religious proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas, speaking to them, persuaded them to continue in the grace of God. How can we persuade you to continue in something that you have no choice in the matter? How can a man continue in the grace of God if God is the only one who can choose for you to do it? See, friends, when grace is confused, grace will be abused, and ultimately you'll reject the very word that will save you, and thus God's grace will be refused. Friends, obey the gospel. Don't listen to what man tells you about God's grace. Just do what our last caller said. You know, study for yourself. Listen, we'll be glad to help you. We'll be glad to study with you. Help to show you where God's grace that has been extended to all men can reach you, even you, if you'll be obedient to the word of his grace. And then, as a child of God, you continue in his grace by walking in the light, continuing his word, and then his grace will continue to cover you and cleanse you from all your sins. 1 John 1, verses 7 through 9. Friends, we're out of time. If we can assist you in any way, we want to do that very thing. All we ask for you to do is reach us, 276-340-2653, or at awordfromthelord@gmail.com. If we can assist you in any way, we want to do that very thing. Thanks for watching. Have a good night.
Views expressed on...
You're traveling to another dimension.
A dimension not only of sight and sound, but of mind. Your next stop...